Good morning, everyone. Are we better today? Not too cold, is it? Today is a special day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. You are welcome to St. Paul's Church, Barton. My name is Reverend Doze Moneme. I'm the vicar here at St. Paul's Church. Later in the service, my beloved brother, Reverend Kelvin, will be bringing God's word to us as we continue our sermon series on 40 days with Jesus. But today is a special day for us, isn't it? It is Modern Sunday. Because of COVID, as a church, we will not be able to distribute flowers and cards. However, I'm going to say a prayer before I hand over to Andrew for notices. So let us pray for our mothers. Almighty God, we thank you for the love of our mothers, for their patience when tested, for their love when tired, for their hope when despairing, for their service without limit, for their care and concern, for the joys they have shared with us, for the pains they have borne for us. We pray especially for mothers who are lonely due to COVID restriction. May they know your comfort and presence. We pray for those who have lost mothers or sisters. We ask that you bring others their way to fill this role in their lives. Thank you, God, for all that they give us through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome. Welcome to those who are watching online this morning as well. Before we start this morning, there are some birthdays I think we just need to make mention this morning. Michelle and Gabriel this weekend. Gabriel had has got a special birthday this weekend, and Tristan as well, who's got a very special birthday later on in the week. I'm not going to say anything too much to embarrass them too much, but happy birthday. And I know that the church family really appreciates Tristan's for the work he's done to keep this service live online. So happy birthday to you guys. We'll give them a round of applause. This morning, please do stay in your seats. Josephine and Liz will just direct you. If you need to have a word, if you have a word of knowledge or something to share this morning, please raise your arm nice and high, and Liz will come to you with the microphone on a long boom. And if you're online this morning, you can send them to the usual number 07947 153 344, and we will share those this morning. There is coffee this morning on Zoom at 12 o'clock. If you haven't got the password or the meeting ID, please contact us and we will pass that on to you. We'd continue to encourage you with regular giving. We still have a bit of a deficit on this current financial year, so we do need to look at our finances and encourage you to look at how much you're offering in your weekly offering. Just to bring to attention as well, Revive Newport are doing a walking for 1,000 kilometres to raise £1,000 by the end of April. If you would like to assist Liz and the team and Michelle in that, then please have a chat with them. Next Sunday is worship and communion, and Jane Shivers will be bringing God's word to us. And these subjects of 40 Days with Jesus we followed up in our weekly home groups and fellowship groups as well. I'm done.
Wonderful God, we thank you. Psalm chapter 37 verse 5 says we should commit our ways unto you and trust you that you will do everything. And Lord, we ask your power to come upon your servant Kelvin. May he speak your mind to us and help us, Lord Jesus, not to be just only the hearers, but also to be the doers of your word. Come in our midst this morning and fill this place with your power and your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for that lovely welcome. It was actually quite nice looking out as you were praying for me and seeing people's arms reaching out and surrounding us and me in prayer, so I do appreciate that. Can we join together in the collect for today? I presume it's coming on the screen, is that right? Thank you. I know you won't have the privilege of that at home, but you can hopefully say amen to this prayer. A collect for the fourth Sunday in Lent. Let us pray. Merciful Lord, you know our struggle. Oh, that's not the one that's on the screen. Let us join together. Almighty God, whose most dear Son went not to joy, but first he suffered pain and entered not into glory before he was crucified, mercifully grant that we, walking in the way of the cross, may find it none other than the way of life and peace through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our opening hymn is Beauty for Brokenness. As is part of our current regulations, restrictions that we're led by a cantor, a singer, I will not object if you're humming behind your mask, but please join in your hearts in this song.
Content with
Come to the part of our service where we get a chance just to bring before the Lord those things which we know that we've done or thought or said which are not pleasing in His sight. It's an important part of our spirituality. It's important that we are careful about how we think about our sin and our sinfulness and know that what the Word says is true, that He cleanses us and He frees us and releases us from whatever we bring before Him now. 1 Peter 2:24 says, Christ Himself bore our sins in His body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By His wounds we are healed. So let us confess our sins, knowing that He is able to forgive. Father, we have sinned against heaven and against You. We're not worthy to be called Your children. We turn to You again. Have mercy on us. Bring us back to Yourself as those who once were dead but now have life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Just leave a space for You to bring things that are on Your heart that You wish to release now before I respond to that confession. May God, who loved the world so much that He sent His Son to be our Savior, forgive us our sins, make us holy to serve Him in the world through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Dozie mentioned that it's Mother's Day, and I couldn't resist from telling you a story of from the classroom of a teacher who had taught her class the story or the properties of the magnet. And the next day she put a little test of before the children of the properties of the magnet. And the first question was an easy one to get them going. And it said, my full name has 6 letters. My first letter is M. I pick things up. What am I? To the teacher's great surprise, when she got in the responses, over half of the responses had the word mother rather than magnet. I pick things up. What am I? My mother's passed on now, but she taught me a lot of things. She taught me about humor. She used to tell me, if you fall off that skateboard, don't come running to me. She used to tell me about growing up, and she'd say that if you don't eat your greens, you'll never grow up. So that's why I was always very faithful in eating my greens. She taught me about genetics and said, "You're just like your father." And she taught me about anticipation, saying, "Wait till your father gets home." And I heard that a number of times. And that was how my mother taught me about life, and I have very fond memories. And it's a good day for us to remember and pass that on to those who are with us, who are mothers, and also remember those mothers that we've had. So we're going to have a reading which isn't related to mothers. It's part of the 40 days series that we're doing. And the reading is from John 21. And Jenny's going to read it to us.
Hear the gospel of the Lord. John chapter 21, starting at verse 4. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat and you will find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he'd taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish in it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." Simon Peter climbed aboard and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153, but even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they'd finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said, "you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep. I tell you the truth. When you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go." Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, "Follow me." Peter turned and saw that the disciple whom Jesus loved was following them. This was the one who had leaned back against Jesus at the supper and had said, "Lord, who is going to betray you?" When Peter saw him, he asked, "Lord, what about him?" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be
to God.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth, meditation of our hearts, be acceptable to you, O Lord, our Redeemer. Amen. It's interesting to note that this story is the story that John chooses to finish his gospel with. The Gospel of John finishes with this story. It's quite interesting to look at the last chapter of each of the gospels to see what the others do. But John finishes with this story. showing us that healing and restoration and feeding and being fishers of men and tending sheep is the future of the church, and also the importance of healing and restoration to our church. I'm not talking about buildings, I'm talking about lives. A few years ago, a madman, took a knife and slashed a 7-foot wide hole in a Dutch masterpiece called the Night Watch in the Amsterdam Rijksmuseum. So what did the museum do? Did they say, it's beyond repair? There's nothing we can do for this. Of course not. Of course not. In 2018, they began a process of restoration of that masterpiece. They say it will take years to restore. Let me assure you this morning that you are worth much more than a precious work of art. God knows you. He has plans for your life. If you feel broken or torn, He wants to restore you. He is reaching out to you this morning. In John 21, the story that we've just had, we hear about Simon Peter's restoration. And what a wonderful story it is. Of course, Peter wasn't just a disciple. He was one of the inner circle of three, you could say. He was present at the Transfiguration. He was reading into the story. He was probably the closest physically to Jesus at the time of the Garden of Gethsemane. He was in the inner circle. And yet, he was known as a bit of a motor mouth. He was prone to saying the wrong thing at the wrong times. And perhaps his lowest point was the time when the Thursday before Good Friday, he let himself down. He let Jesus down when he denied Jesus 3 times. Of course, Jesus had predicted that he would do that. Then he heard the cock crow 3 times, and he was broken with the reality that he had let Jesus down. And yet, a few weeks later, he was stood on the temple in Jerusalem, preaching at Pentecost. What had changed? He had met with the risen Jesus Christ, his healer and his restorer. And so as we look at this passage in John 21, there's 3 important lessons that I want us to try and take away with us today. One, that Jesus is present with us in our present struggles. 2, that Jesus heals us from our past failings. And 3, that Jesus reveals to us his future church. So first of all, he is present with us in our present struggles. All of us face struggles and challenges in life. The good news is that Jesus is here with us in our struggles. In this passage in John 21, we read that the disciples, even though they were experienced fishermen, had caught nothing. And yet, Jesus comes on the scene. And he says, I'll read it to you, early in the morning, it's right at the start of the reading that Jenny gave to us, early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples didn't realize that it was Jesus, and he called out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? Throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. And when they did it, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. The key point is here that is that Jesus was right there wanting to help them. This story can be a picture of our own struggles in life. whether it's struggles through this pandemic that we have, struggles of lockdown, of not being able to see family or mix and mingle the way we want to, or struggles with jobs, struggles with money, struggles with work, or lockdown, or furlough. This story can be a picture of our situation. Life is difficult. But the message here is that we shouldn't battle on thinking that we can be stoic and we can make it through without knowing that the Lord is with us, present with us in our present struggles. And here Jesus demonstrates that he has all the knowledge and power that we need to pass through our struggles. He knows more about fish than the fishermen. He knows more about you and your struggles than you do. And he is alive and present and with us by his Holy Spirit, an ever-present help at our time of trouble, we say in Psalm 46. There's never a situation that we will face where he is not there. Even if we don't recognize him, the promise is that he is present with us in our present struggle. What a wonderful picture we have at the end of that struggle with their fishing problem. Their struggle then became that they couldn't haul the load in. So abundant was God's provision for them. But not only does Jesus help us in our present struggles, but he heals us in our past failure. I love barbecues. We had our first barbecue of the season just last week. I think I'd have a barbecue every day, well, at least once a week if my wife would let me. It's one of my favorite things. I think it's a sociable thing. It's getting round the fire and flipping fish and burgers, and there's something lovely about standing round the coals and having a barbecue, and hopefully soon we'll get back into that. And this story has a story of barbecue and charcoal fire. And Jesus brings them round a charcoal fire and charcoals fish and takes some of their catch. And you can imagine how sociable it is there in that scene. There's only one other time in the New Testament that this word for charcoal fire is mentioned, and that is in John 18. The time when Peter stood round a charcoal fire and warmed himself as he denied Jesus three times. Isn't that strange? That Jesus brings him back to the place of his failing, bringing him back because he wants to heal him. He wants to restore him. He doesn't want to just move on and cast it as if it didn't matter. He brings him back to the scene. And he doesn't say, Peter, do you remember when you chickened out and you let me down? He doesn't say, promise me, Peter, that you won't chicken out again. Because of course Peter would have said, yes, Lord, I promise I won't chicken you out again. That's not what Jesus did. Jesus took him to the root of the problem, asking him the question that caused his downfall. The question was, Peter, do you love me more than these? Taking him back to the time on the Thursday when we had the Last Supper picture. And Peter had said to Jesus, again with one of his motor mouth things, that even if all these people desert you, Lord, I will never do that. He was saying, I love you, Lord, more than these guys could ever do. He was Mr. Dependable. But actually what he was revealing is that he was self-sufficient. He was self-affirming. In fact, Peter loved himself more than he loved Jesus, and his pride was shining through, and that was his fall. And Jesus took him back to that situation and asked him the question, do you love me, 3 times? But to be fair, it wasn't that bad. It wasn't that bad. Peter just chickened out. It wasn't as if he'd been caught in adultery. It wasn't as if he'd cheated in an exam. He hadn't robbed a bank. You know, if you think about it, it's not the end of the world what happened. And this is very important for us as we read this, because we can all stand where Peter stands and say, I could be there. And I have been there. I have denied the Lord. I have let him down. I have chickened out. So let us not think that this is something that is in a story in the Holy Book. This is also our story. Because all what Jesus is revealing to Peter, and what we need to learn, is that all of sin involves us nudging the Lord out of the center of our lives and pushing ourselves back in to the center. All of sin. And Jesus is revealing to Peter and to us that he is falling short on the very first commandment of the Ten Commandments. It would be good for us to have it as a memory verse for all times, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. That was the root of Peter's sinfulness. And in revealing to Peter that that's where his failing was, he was able to restore him. Notice that in the third time when Jesus asked him the question, do you love me? Peter was hurt. It says Peter was hurt. In our repentance, it has to hurt. When we face up to our failings, it has to hurt. Because we are hurting Jesus. And that is what hurts. I love the fact that Jesus gave him a second chance. He is the Lord of the second chance. When I was a young lad in my 20s, I had a thing about Ford Capri cars. I think I had 3 Ford Capri cars, one after the other. One would fall foul. And then I ended up getting the second last Ford Capri ever off the production line at Ford. My father was a Ford dealer, and but tractors rather than cars, but he said that the production line is finishing Capris. I can get you one. Do you want it? I got the second last Ford Capri ever made. And it was my pride and joy. I was a youth worker then. I used to tell the kids that Jesus would have driven a Ford Capri. It's a Jesus type of car. And I was one of those boy racer guys. But anyway, this is digressing slightly. But tragedy happened. I went out to my garage in Wakefield one day. By this stage, I was a reverend, a minister, was I? Yeah. And I found the garage was empty. My Capri had gone. And some crooks in Wakefield had taken my Capri. And would you believe it, that day in the church, it was a special commemorative day for the police force. And I said to one of the police officers who was in my church, I needed your guys today because my car has been nicked. And he says, I'll get the boys onto it. My car was found that afternoon in some railway lines down in some fields in Wakefield. It was wrecked, absolute wrecked. They'd been running it in the fields, and the car was a total write-off. I didn't want it to be written off. I bought it back off the insurance company. That Capri became for me a picture of the second chance. And I sent it off, and I took the insurance money, and I got it restored, and I got the Capri back, and it was a picture for me of the second chance. And I love the fact that Jesus gave Peter a second chance, and many second chances, and gives us all second chances. And today, if you feel pain or shame of past failure, I encourage you from this story to turn to the Lord in prayer. Read again this story, John 18, John 21, read it again, and let yourself run to the Lord and realize that He is the one who can restore you from past failures. You're far more precious than a Dutch masterpiece. He has plans for you. He wants to heal and restore you, not only from the damage done to us by others, but from the damage we do to ourselves by our own sinfulness. He doesn't just patch us up. He makes all things new. Thirdly, Jesus reveals to us His future church. The first thing Jesus said to Peter, we hear it in the Gospels, is "Follow me." The last thing Peter says to Jesus, we read it in this story, is "Follow me." So we're calling this sermon talk "Overcoming Failure." But it's not us that overcomes the failure. It's because the Lord is with us in those situations. We overcome because He is with us and in us. As I said earlier, this is the last story in the Gospel of John. And as a church, as we pray ourselves out of lockdown, it's important for us to receive guidance as to how the church should look. This church, your church, wherever you may be listening and watching this, how the church will come out of this lockdown. How should we look? And I believe this story is a metaphor of the future church that the Lord was opening to the disciples there. Jesus was saying to the church, "Eat with me," like we do in Holy Communion. He was saying, "Run to me when you fail and fall." He was saying, "Be people of mission, be fishers of men, fishers of people, tending sheep, feeding lambs." The future of the church should look like this, not a church of good causes, not a church that enters into politics and tries to make itself look a bit like the world or a religious organization, but a church that is like the city on the hill that Jesus talked about in the Sermon on the Mount. Not a suburb of the city that is the world, but a city that they can look up to and see, "It looks different. I want to be in that city." Anglicans say the creed virtually each week. "I believe in God the Father. I believe in God the Son. I believe in God the Holy Spirit." What do we say after that? Shout out, somebody. What comes after that? Anybody? "I believe in the Holy Worldwide, Holy Catholic Church." Do you know, I think it takes more faith to believe in the church these days than it does to believe in God. And that's a travesty of what we have become as church. The world, as it looks at the church, it doesn't see a city on a hill that it wants to be, to run to and to receive feeding and nurture and receive from. The church, some of the churches we see I struggle to see if we could even call them holy. I'm being a little bit controversial. I believe in the Holy Church. We say it every week, and the church has become something that looks more like a worldly version of an organization of doing good and doing some political things. When Jesus teaches us in this story that we should be fishers of men, that was the first thing that he said to Peter when he said, "Follow me." That's mission. And then in this story, he said, when he asked him, "Do you love me?" The first thing he said is, "Feed my lambs." He didn't say, "Feed my laborers." He didn't say, "Feed my lions." "Feed my lambs," the young, the weak, the vulnerable. The second time he said, "Tend my sheep." The word used for tend there is the same word in the Greek for pastoring, to give pastoral care, spiritual, emotional, mental care and support. Pastoral care. "Tend my sheep." And all three times he says, "Feed my lambs, feed my sheep, feed my sheep," when Jesus brings Peter back to being healed and restored. When Jesus refers to these people, they are his. These are people that he has ownership of, people that he cares about, and he wants us to reach out to them, to tend and to feed and to care for. This is the church. It's a metaphor of fishing. It's a metaphor of tending and feeding sheep. Mixed metaphors, if your mind has gone crazy with all the different pictures of or metaphors, then well done to you for hanging in there. But I hope it inspires you to think again about how are we going to come out of this pandemic, out of this lockdown. Will we be a people of mission, a people of tending and caring for the weak and the young and the needy and pastoring people? That's the picture I believe Jesus gives us for this church here, St. Paul's at Barton, a GAFCON member. That's the picture that he gives us, I believe, to the church worldwide, not trying to look like the world, but to be a fellowship, a communion of people reaching out to others, tending and feeding. It's all part and parcel of what it means to follow Jesus. Shall we pray? Lord, I thank you for this challenge from your scriptures. Thank you that it is a living word. Open our hearts to hear again your word to us. Lord, we've sang in that beauty for brokenness. Give us compassion, we pray. Melt our cold hearts. Let tears fall like rain. Come, change our love from a spark to a flame. Amen.
Let's stand and worship the Lord this morning. We're going to start with King of Love and Grace. Let's stand and worship this morning. King of love and grace.
King of love and grace, my guardian, all my hopes and fears are in your hands. I'm in your hands. Where you go, I'll go. Show me the way. Every step I take, be now my guide. God on my side. You go before me. Your promises will stand forever. You're my defender. You go before me. You're there beside me. And if I wander, love will find me. Goodness and mercy will always follow. Yours, and we will trust in you. You are God, our great defender, strong in love, forever faithful. We are yours, and we will trust in you.
Who you
maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you.
Way maker. who you are. That is who you are. The Lord is my shepherd. He restores my soul. Me by still waters, he restores my soul. Surely your goodness and mercy are chasing after me all of the days of my life. Even when I'm lost in the deepest valley, silence falls around me, I know you hear me. Even when it feels like we're separated, you're holding on to me. You lift my head, you wipe my tears, you restore my soul. Your embrace, you restore my soul. Surely your goodness and mercy are chasing after me all of the days of my life. Even when I'm lost in the deepest valley, no evil, even when the silence falls around me, I know you hear me. Even when it feels like we're separated, you're holding on to me. Oh, even when I'm lost in the deepest valley, you're holding on to me. Even when the silence falls around, you're holding on to me. Even when it feels like we're separated, you're holding on to me. You restore my soul. You restore my soul. You restore my soul.
Dear Heavenly Father, restore your church so that we are a light on a hill to the folk in the community. And thank you for being our God. In Jesus' name we give thanks. Amen.
You're always working. You never stop working, even when we can't see. When we think that nothing can help, you're still there, you're working. Then something amazing happens and we see restoration, we see healing, we feel your peace and love. You're always working. We always have to trust in you that you're there and you hear our prayers and you answer our prayers. Because you're always working. We bless and praise your name. Thank you. Thank you. Amen.
And Father, this morning, we bring our prayers and our thanksgivings to you. Father, we thank you for our mothers on Mothering Sunday. We thank you for their love and their care for us. We pray for those who have lost their mum and who are remembering this morning. And for mothers who are grieving over the loss of a child, Father, please come and heal. We pray for mums and children who'll be unable to meet today due to distance and for many other reasons, Lord. Please comfort them. And sometimes, Lord, relationships may be broken between mothers and their children. Please come, heal and restore, Lord. Father, this morning can bring mixed emotions and feelings, but we thank you for your love and your care. For Iris and for Jill. We pray for healing and reconciliation as well in families. We pray for Michelle's family and for Sue's family too. Pray for our government and for our nation. We pray, Lord, that there will be a turning back to you and a relying upon you for all things. Have mercy upon this nation. We pray for our world as well. This time, Lord Jesus, have mercy upon us. And we pray for Israel this morning, a promise to Israel, a promise for Israel, from Isaiah 41, verse 14. Do not be afraid, O worm of Jacob, O little Israel, for I myself will help you, declares the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel.
Pray for the royal family at this time, Lord, especially after that interview of the week, last week, Lord. And pray for your healing touch on Prince Philip, Lord. May be with him at this difficult time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Perfect love. my song will ever be. I am found in Jesus. O perfect love, my song will ever be. I am found in Jesus.
Perfect love, my song will ever be. I am found in Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name.
Drawing to the conclusion of our service, I'm going to lead you in a blessing, and we'll then stand for our final hymn. May Christ give you grace to follow in holiness, to deny yourselves, take up your cross and follow him. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon those and you, those you know and love. Remain with you always. Amen. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Let's stand and sing our concluding hymn, These Are the Days of Elijah.